All right, so I've had 3 days to play around with this game, and I can say that it's the craziest computer RPG I've ever played. It's nuts. It's everything about it is like you're on drugs, or they were drunk, or they were doing something crazy when they wrote this, because it's just, it's nuts. It's so hard to even explain to somebody how crazy it is. The mechanics in the game are very unique and very different than most computer games, RPGs. The turn-based combat and everything is very familiar, but how, you know, they use action points, it's kind of like an action point system, but they pull from 3 different pools. And, you know, it's taken me about 2 days to actually get pretty good at this. The thing about this game that is really different, and I'm kind of on the fence about it right now, is how monumental your choices are. You could probably play this entire game without combat at all if you wanted to. But there are choices that you can make in this game that have serious, serious negative impacts. Even from the very beginning of the game. So here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna start completely over. I'm gonna whiz by a number of the conversations unless it's pertinent that you select something. I'm gonna hit some key things that you should pick up along the way, but think of this as your guide to, if you create a character, these are the very first things that you should do. There's one critical, ultimately critical decision that you make at the very beginning of this game, and it can potentially affect everything. So I'm gonna warn you now that this video is gonna be full of spoilers. This is basically, you've started playing it and you've done some things and you're like, it just doesn't feel right. This will make things much easier for you and definitely will allow you to kind of progress a little bit further. So with that, I'm gonna go ahead and start a new game. Now, I've also played a couple of different characters. I've played male and female, and I can tell you that the female character looks horrendous. I can't even stand looking at her.
The body is without warning. The cocoon instinctively.
So the only thing you need to do here is you need to flatten out at least once, because I've actually done this where I keep going and going and you just die and the game's over.
And they're still plummeting.
So the choices don't really matter other than that, so just do that. In the beginning here, too, you have to move this little dish. It doesn't matter whether you fail the check or not. You still get past it. It has no impact. So I would suggest clicking it, using your might. Now, here's something interesting. So I have 5 points, and I didn't really realize this at first. So you can actually do all your actions without expending any points at all. This little symbol here lets me know I have 5 points. If I click this, I won't spend anything, but I only have a 45% chance. As soon as I start expending points, my chances go up. So oftentimes in these conversations, you can do this intro one, and a lot of times, even when it's 45%, you'll do it. But if you don't, you'll get a chance to retry it by expending an additional point. And most of the time, your percent chance to do it actually goes up. So you can go ahead and blast all your points away on something you want to be really sure of, but there's really no need, and especially in this particular one. So there, I just clicked it and I got it. The other thing I'll tell you is, because this game and its choices are so drastic, saving and quick saving and reloading, I do it constantly. There are some purists out there, some hardcore players out there that, you know, they hate doing that and they think it's cheating or whatever. You know, I like playing the game just to see the story. I like the progression. I like seeing new gear and new skills and seeing how it works in the world. You know, for me, that's really what these games are about. Now, like I said in the first video, this actually is the character creator. I thought it was. I wasn't certain when I first played it, but now I know. It's the character creator, and as you select these different options, it customizes your character along the way. But at the very end here, you can still pick everything that you want. So it's really irrelevant what you pick here. It has no bearing on the game. So for me, I'm just going to cycle through it as fast as possible just to get through so we can actually get into the character creator. Now, there are three classes in the game. There's a glaive, a jack, and a nano. Glaive is kind of a tank, heavy weapon, heavy armor user. Jack is kind of somewhere in between. You know, they can kind of do all kinds of things. They call it a jack of all trades. And then you have a nano, which is essentially like a space wizard. I always like playing those classes, so I'm going to go ahead and play that again right now for this example. So when you click on the mirror here, this is where it tells you this is the kind of the person you are. Pointed a doppelganger, and yeah, that's me. So it automatically assigned a descriptor here based on my selections, but again, I can change all of this. So here, it started me off as a strong jack. Okay, I'm actually going to go to nano. Here, I'll move the video window here. So you can see glaive, jack, nano, and it gives you a little bit of, you know, what they are. So I'm going to select a nano. See, right now I'm a strong nano, and it kept my descriptor, which you'll see a little bit later here, as strong, and I can change that. It also has my initial selections here as well. So these are my initial abilities. I'm going to go ahead and jack my intelligence here because that'll be my main stat pool. The first thing I did when I created this was scan thoughts, and it is pretty cool because you can kind of judge what the other person's thinking, but I thought that would actually have more impact on how the conversation went, but it doesn't seem to very much. So it kind of seemed, I think it's more of a flavor skill. Obviously innervate for healing is good, and being able to carry more ciphers is always a good thing too. This potentially could be good, but you know, sometimes combat can be over in like two rounds, and if you spend an entire round just trying to protect yourself, you know, not so good. So I'm going to leave that off for right now. So now my exploration skill. From what I've seen, these lore skills, they're all fairly, they're used equally. So, you know, machinery or mysticals. So I'll select mystical since I'm kind of a space wizard, right? No weapon skills. So here's where you pick your descriptor. I'm currently, it automatically selected strong. So that's why I have 8, 5, and 7 here. But I can do mystical here, which gives me the lore mystical. And you can see it boosted that one and an additional cipher use. Okay. But I have -1 intimidation. I could also do learned, right? This is a pretty good one. Now, the thing I don't like about this one is this persuasion and deception. These do impact your conversation points in the game. So there's things that I've noticed a lot is persuasion and deception. There are tons of options for that. There are tons of options for quick fingers. And so that, where's that? Slick. So this is actually the one that I picked the last time, and I think it's a good choice because you get persuasion and you get a bonus to quick fingers and you lose endurance. Okay, so what's going to happen is I'm going to have 18 hit points instead of 20, and because I actually have an inability at endurance, so that means instead of 5 health per level, I'm going to get 3 instead. So you're not as tough, but there's not a ton of combat in this game. And when you have 3 other companions and you're shooting at range, it's not the end of the world, I don't think. So for me, I think this is a really good trade-off because this persuasion and quick fingers, you're going to use this a lot in the game. So I'm going to go ahead and save this. The other thing to note is there's 0 character customization. You know, a lot of people complain about that, you know, because this is a computer role-based game or role-playing game, and that's a pretty big piece of it. You know, would I have liked to been able to do that kind of like you could in Pillars? Absolutely. But you know, the game is really cool. It's really different. It's just crazy. I mean, I've been dreaming about it. I've been thinking about it. I mean, I'm really, really loving this game so far. All right, so you generally want to hit all the conversation points that you can. Just so you get, because sometimes you'll get additional options. That'll give you a couple XP points here and there. Alright, so I'm going to try to whiz through this. Alright. Okay, so I got to kill these guys. Go ahead. So here's I'm using basic attack here. I'm not going to hit 65%, and I'm going to not use any points at all. Hopefully I'll hit. Yeah, I hit. This next one, it kind of shows you just how to move. You can move, and at the end of your turn, you see right here, there's a blue, little blue line there, and then it turns purple. That means I'm moving into my action as well. If I moved here, I could still have an action. That's my movement turn, I'd still have an action. But it doesn't put me close enough to this guy. So I'm gonna move over here. Because there's a shard right here. You don't see it quite yet. But it's right here, it'll show up next. So now it's my turn, I'm gonna go ahead and hit this guy. So you can also see the health bar there? As I move up, the health bar goes down, meaning if I hit, I'll kill this guy. So there we go. It's a way to kind of judge and save your points for whatever you need. Now, let's see, does this show up? No, I gotta end my turn. I'm gonna end my turn here. Now this next guy, just because I know this, because I've played it through a number of times, you can't physically hit this guy. And for characters that are all physical, they put this cipher in here to use. Okay, it does 13 damage. Well, thing is, I can hit this thing using some of my magic ability, or my esoteries, right? An esoteric attack. So I'll do energy, why not? So, yeah, the first hit will kill it. So I gained 40 XP, and I have the item. If you played another class, you'd have to use that item to actually kill that guy. So I figured, why not save it? All right, so the next thing to do is go through the portal here. Now you wake up, and this is where the game starts.
Where did he fall from?
Again, I'm just going to try to zoom through all of this stuff just to kind of show you what you should do.
All I saw was a corona.
Because this will take me probably.
But look, he's healing already.
Half an hour, 45 minutes, maybe an hour to get where I need to be. It's a really good starting point. Very specific set of things that you should do. All right, so I didn't even know this, but I got this pre-order bonus, which is pretty good. For someone who uses esoteric, though, it's terrible. But it's worth a bunch of coin, so hang on to it. So now I just try to hit all of the conversation points as quick as I can. You You can see it appends again, or tell me again, or something like that, but you'll see that in the conversation if you've asked it. That right there is when you have a lapse in your memory, or remembering a lapse in your memory. This whole game is about recovering your memory and figuring out where you were and who you were and what you are and so on. So that place that you were right before here was your subconscious. And you'll travel back there quite a bit. All right, so I just picked up the main storyline quest. Okay, so you have two choices. You have, you know, the man or the woman here. I like Allegern. He's the man. He's more of a melee nano, so he doesn't use he doesn't have any ranged esoteric attacks. He uses melee attacks. And you get a weapon right off the bat that he's really good with, that he can use. So I'm going to select him. But it's really up to you. You don't have to select one or the other. And you don't have to pick to go with one or the other. It doesn't really matter initially. All right, so I've asked everything. Okay, so I hit the tab, and I can see there are one, two, three, four things I have to pick. Right here is, there's a weapon that you'll want to get to start, and it's a really good starter weapon. So just examine everything here, inspect the metal rings. This doesn't really do shards on the ground. This is, pick up one of the crystal shards, okay? This is actually your first weapon. There's nothing else useful there. Now I go ahead and here's our first quick fingers. Okay, there's quick fingers everywhere. So here's how I do this, right? I click on me without spending any points. I have actually I just failed it. Great, 75% chance that I fail it. I'm gonna go ahead and what I should have done there is I should have saved right before. Every time before an action, I quick save. Because
yes.
It's like that one. I thought I'd have another chance to get it, but no. For this one, no good.
Where did he fall from?
Many other times, you'll have another chance, and you'll just go ahead and get it. You just spend an extra point. But now, I totally lost out on whatever that is that you get from here. And it's just if it's a money
item.
And money's a big thing in this game in the beginning. So you want to make sure that you get all the money items that you can, as much as you can. All right, fortunately, we have to do this again. Let's try to speed through it, dismiss that. Flash for your memory.
I'll remember that.
Oops, I didn't mean to select that. All right, so I'm gonna hit F5 to save this time.
Fine.
Let's go ahead and get the shards again. This is a freebie. So I'll go in my inventory here and you'll see it's crystalline shard. It's a light melee weapon. I have no negative impacts for using light weapons, so it's a decent weapon for my class. Now here's the armor that you get for the pre-order. Now it's actually kind of horrible. I don't know what the purpose of it is. I get -3 to might, -3 to speed, and -15% on esoteric attacks. I don't know why anybody would wear this. I get 10% on weapon attacks, but it looks to me like the negatives far outweigh the positives. Yeah, these guys are all wearing light armor, so maybe I haven't come across much other armor in the game. Maybe it's all like this, and maybe this is good for something that gives you an armor rating of 4. So I'm going to hang on to it for right now, but here's the crystalline shard. I have it equipped. So I'm going to save it again, quick save. Now let's try this again. Quick fingers, okay. 75%, boom, did it. Okay, so I got the spray flesh thing and 19 shins, which is your money. Go ahead and leave. Let's go ahead and pick up what's in this crate right here. Take all that. F5, because I'm going to interact with something new. Always save it. All right, so there's a... You want to have them show you the arch, and you want to use this skill. 80%. That's pretty good. Didn't spend any points. Got it. Whenever I see some of these where you can examine something again and again, I do it a couple times just to be certain. Okay, so now I just unleash the contents of Cell Zero. I got some XP, and I got another cipher. And then that's it for that. Okay, so this room, you can examine all these other things if you want, but there's nothing else of any value in here. So the first thing you're going to want to do when you get out of here is you're going to want to talk to Alger.
What do you need? This is the Reef of Fallen Worlds, kid. It's a dangerous place at the best of times. And with you lighting up the sky as you fell, well, we should get out of here as soon as possible.
Yeah, there's nothing significant there. I think what they're trying to show you there is that your companions are going to want to talk to you throughout the adventure, and there are things that are going to happen when you do that. So, anyhow, first thing you want to do is interact with these little floaty guys. Again, here's Quick Fingers, exactly like I said. Actually, I'm going to leave it alone, because you know what? I forgot to save it. Let's hit it again. Quick Fingers. Boom, got it right off the bat. Gain 2 XP each, and that's really all that is. Just to show you, oh, I gained 2 more XP. So I got 4 out of that. Okay, there's a little container here. Let's grab that.
In this world, then.
Okay, so right here is where you get your first weapon that I was telling you about that I'll give to Allegrin when I get it. But there's two things that happen here, and I didn't know this until I failed it once. Because every time I did it, I succeeded and I got the weapon. But when you fail, you get scratched and it injures you, but it permanently increases your health by 1 point. I figure, you know, having the weapon, a really decent weapon right off the bat, is more important than 1 health point. You know, it's up to you, but you have to fail it to get the health. If you succeed, actually, let's save it here. I forgot if I did that or not.
All right.
And let's go ahead and get this. Smashing is also a big thing that I see a lot, but I think Allegrin is actually good at it. Yes, 60% off the bat. So you can. So I select each of the characters and I see what their base value is. So he's got a 60% chance. There. So it did it right off the bat. 8-fingered mace. Good. This is actually a really good weapon. You can't really. There's nothing else you can do here, so you can just walk away. So I'm going to give it to Allegrin, because it's actually pretty good. It's better than what he has. Now, here's another thing here. You picked up the crystal shard, remember? So you're going to want to touch this thing with your shard. And what it does is it infuses your crystal shard. Stretch a crystal shard toward the obelisk. You get some XP, and it actually makes your weapon better. Now, I've also touched this thing, and there's a quick fingers thing. It doesn't really do anything unless you fail, and if you fail, it vaporizes you, and your game's over. So, yes. Don't do that. Next thing, go on up here, and you're going to touch this. You can get two items out of this. Okay, so here's quick fingers again and perception. So I have a 75% chance without expending any points, and she does as well. I'm going to use her. Boom, she got it. Good. So I get this fresh vapors here, right? So I can examine the sledge, search for more. Keep waiting. There you go. You get a little XP, and then you get this glow. But that's it. I suppose it's possible that there's more in there, but I mean, I've done it a bunch of times and haven't seen anything, so maybe if you come back to it at a later date. There's some containers up here. There's a door here that's interactable, yes. But you won't do anything. It won't do anything yet. So this next part is your very first chance to do combat or not. Now, originally when I did this, I didn't do the combat because I was under the impression that rewards and everything were going to be the same no matter what option, and that all that mattered was that you finished the quest or the side quest or the adventure or the crisis. But that wasn't the case. I think I got like 25 XP when I avoided it, and if you attack them and win, you get like 100 XP, but on top of it, which I think is more important, is you get a slew of items from that what they're carrying. And the money that you'll make from selling some of this stuff will kind of significantly help you along the way. And the combat isn't really that difficult anyhow. So I am going to do it. I'm going to save before I get up here.
I'm going.
I'm going to move over here, and it'll stop me, and the combat the guys will come out. Now, the only thing you need to do to force this combat is there's an option to say, get out of my way. Now, I hit the other conversation options just to be safe, but I don't think you even need to do that. You can basically say, you know, you got to get to the point where you've got this. You're in my way, move or I'll make you. But I like to chatter a little bit first, so. Exhaust all the other options. Now you're in my way, move or I'll make you move. Now go ahead and attack. Now I'm going to show you something really cool about this, which is, I think, somewhat unique as well. Alright, so this guy, Koro, you do not want to kill this guy right off the bat, because if you do, the rest of the guys will flee and you won't get anything for him. So I save him actually for last. Now, with my guy, I'm going to run up here. And I'll show you why.
Yes.
Because this thing you can interact with. And it's really awesome, right? But it uses might. I'm not really great at might. Here's 80% or 100%. I don't use might a whole lot, so I'm just going to make sure I get it. So I do 100% there. So I've essentially activated this thing. And it's an area of effect. And you got to be careful because it won't hit these guys over there. But if you move right at the right angle, it'll get these two guys. And there's a third guy that's hidden in here. It'll hit that one too. So it does some decent damage, and it does a damage over time as well. So the first thing I'm gonna do with Allegern is he's got these living tattoos, and you can do this once every crisis, and it's active for the entire crisis. And it counts as one of his movements. And essentially, if he continues to do the same thing over and over again, his thing that he's doing gets more powerful, no matter what it is. So if he's just doing melee, he's gonna do better and better melee. So he's gonna run and he's gonna smack this guy. And I'm gonna do an all-out attack, and it's gonna almost kill him. Now, I have an option with her. So I can tell you what's gonna happen. I can do this right here. I can interact here, and it does an area debuff for everybody. But what'll happen is this Koro, he'll heal this guy. So I have another round of this guy. So I think what is preferred is I'm going to try to take him out instead. So she's got a 75% chance. I'm going to do 95 just to be safe.
something I've learned.
Yeah, so he's done. So now I'm gonna end her turn. Actually, you know what? I should have done something different. I'll show you next time. You should kind of always do this with her because she gets it every turn. So this little thing here, Koro has he's got a trap device, and it's this little mudslinger here. Ooh, so I got hit pretty good there. So I should probably heal myself. Yeah, you know what? See, I don't think. I don't think I will be able to hit these guys from here. So I'm probably gonna heal myself. So now it should be Allegern's turn. You can see up here, his turn is next. And I think I'll move my guy. You know? Yeah, yes. I think I'll move him here. Allegern's turn, he can flank her. And I'm gonna haul off. Yeah, one hit. See ya. That was a good hit. Now I'm gonna move him too, because he's all melee. He's gotta get in range of these guys. Alright, so now it's her turn. And you know, just to show you, I'm gonna go ahead and do this. I'm gonna do this thing. It consumes my action here, so let's make sure we do it. Yeah, so now they're demoralized. And, okay, so this is the thing I was telling you about. She's got this once a turn. She can do this dimensional super positioning. And it makes her more vulnerable to transdimensional damage. So if you're fighting something that's doing that sort of damage, you're not going to want to do this. These guys aren't. And she teleports. And when she appears, she's phased, which makes her harder to hit. So. Thing again. Missed. Alright, so Koro keeps running away, which is fine. Now it's my attack, so I'm going to use my Onslaught, that's a Terry. I'll just use Energy, that's fine. And I'm going to unload on this guy, which is not very good to begin with. I only have a 60% chance.
Surrender.
Oof, I hit him hard and knocked him down. That's interesting. So I'm gonna move. Oh no, I'm immobilized. I can't move. So it's Allegern's turn. And I'm gonna have him finish up because this is the only guy he can hit. 100%. And she can dead. Yeah, you see how his attack, he hit for 14 there? That's because he's got those living tattoos, and as he's attacking with the melee every time, it's getting more and more powerful. Now, this red circle means she's out of range. So, let me see. I should probably teleport someone. And then I'm going to do the Onslaught. And I'm going to hit him with as much as I can. He's hobbled. Koro's turn. Now, Koro wants to give up now. You've killed all of his companions. But I say forget it and take him out anyhow. Because you want his goodies, right? I'm immobilized. I can't do anything. He's too far away to even hit. So I guess what I'll do is I'll heal up again a little bit.
Breathe again.
Yeah, that's that innervate ability that I picked early on. Being able to heal yourself is always a good thing, so.
On it.
Oh, now I can move. Alright, so whose turn is it? Allegern? Yeah, so he's gonna wail on this guy. Oh yeah, see now he hit for 17. Okay, so we just won that. Now, the last thing that's left is you gotta turn off the trap.
Naturally.
And that requires some skill points here, so you just gotta have one of your guys. Quick fingers, lore machinery. So let's see, she's got quick fingers. Let's just, for the sake of making it happen. Yeah, so everyone got 100 XP there, right? That was pretty good. Traps disabled. Okay, now these two get in a fight, and you have to choose which one you go with. I'll go with Alvin.
As you wish. Should you change your mind?
And if you want to, it's a later point, you can pick her up, but he goes away. The two of them can't be in the party at the same time.
A farewell to you, child, and Ben.
Let's go.
So now, pick up all your loot. And there's some decent loot here.
Let's go.
For the beginning of the game.
These ciphers are killing me.
Alright, so I've got too many ciphers right now, so I gotta offload one of them. Okay, and none of these weapons are better than what your guys are using right now, so. And look, I've almost leveled up once already, and the game just started.
Right.
When I first did this, it took me forever to kind of level up because I was avoiding a lot of this stuff because I thought it was the same. So that's really it for this first section. So move on to the next. The first guy you want to talk to is this Oturo guy. This kind of sets up the chain of events for the next quest. Basically, you just gotta chat him up a little bit.
Don't remember that.
There, fallen to earth, it advances that. Yes, I'm the changing god. Keep that in mind. I try to hit all the points here. Yeah, you want to get to that point where it advanced. I'm sorry. Actually, I think we advanced the Falling Star. That was the one that we needed to do.
Updated my journal.
You asked him about what's happening. Oh, do you know anyone how to fix machinery? Okay, so that just kind of sets everything up. First thing you want to do is you're going to want to talk to this guy, Tiber. It'll set in motion a quest series. But he'll also join your party, so now you have three guys in your party, and he's pretty good, too.
I say, you look like someone who believes in justice. How'd you like to help a poor soul wrongfully condemned?
So what's your plan? So you have an option to get the crowd to go against it, but you don't want to do that. It's just not as good of a path. You want to take this clerk path. You can ask about it, and then say, "All right, I'll help you." And then he'll say he wants to join. Say, "Thanks, I could use the help."
Updated my journal.
Okay, this next step is very important. Okay, you could immediately move on to the next step in the quest, but don't. Talk to this guy, okay? And if you don't talk to him, the next time you see him for the next step of this quest, you're not going to be presented with this series of questions that you get a bunch of loot out of. So I love loot. It's like my whole point in playing these games. I like getting new stuff, and anytime I have an opportunity to do that, that's what I want to do. So all you have to do is talk to this guy. Don't pay him. Just ask about the execution. Ask about everything. What would it take to free Riss? Okay. So you've asked about Riss. Tell me what's happening here. Yes. Who are you? I want to talk to Riss. So don't do this deception. Absolutely not. Don't do this one. Don't give him any money. Just say farewell at this point. And now you've advanced this to a point where when you come back and talk to him, you'll have a new set of options that'll give you new loot. All right, so now you've got this guy in your party. There's a little side quest right here. Okay, so I'd say pick this up while you're at it. You know what? I take that back. I say you go pick up a fourth companion, right? Because you want all your guys to level up as much as you can, because obviously they're going to be better. And I believe it's City's Edge over here. And you can pick up the fourth companion, and he'll get XP all along the way. Yeah, sure. He's right down here. It's this guy, Eridus. He's pretty good too. So this is going to be my starting group.
I know what you're thinking. How in the world did you survive that crash, Eridus? The answer is, as it always is, backflips. But hold on. How did you know my name? Never mind. Not important. Yes.
All right. So, we now got four guys, which means they'll all four get XP, and it's a good starting setup anyhow. So you're going to want to use them to begin with anyhow. All right, sure so enough. Now let's go talk to Balthazar. That's this guy right here. Balthazar, I guess is his name. Oops, I wandered into here. That's okay. We need to hit this anyhow. This will be one of the next pieces that we do. I just got to kind of wait for this to play out. All right, so you gotta talk to him about the creature. You're planning something, and you kill it. You can talk to him. You can raise your tides in a couple of different ways. Say, all right, give me the device. I'll see what I can do. Okay, so there's two paths to this. You can actually do what he wants to do. Okay, and you can teleport this creature, and then later you have to go fight it and. He's super tough, and it takes a while to be able to get to him, and the battle itself takes a while. Well, I've looked at both, just because the other thing you do is just turn him in to this guy who is the creature owner, and you know, you get, I think, 40 XP if you take the creature, or you get 25 here. You know, it's not really worth it to wait and have this guy out there and the hassle, because it's a total pain. So I just talk to this guy right away, and I turn him in. I get a bunch of someone, blah, blah, blah. So yeah, tell him that this guy asked you to steal him. And then I do go ahead and, I give him the notes. So I get 25 XP, and I get the Sigic Guard, which gives me an additional cipher that I can carry, I believe. So I'm going to go ahead and equip that right away.
To action!
All right, so we finished that. Now, next thing we want to do, we want to go up here. Say, all right, I'll ask them.
Was looking into something.
Yes.
All right, and then you want to talk to this guy, Sangalin. I'm going to go ahead and save it because there's some checks here, some, I think, quick fingers checks that you have to do. So what do you sell here? And then here it is, quick fingers. So what you're trying to do is steal this badge from him, Okay, so I got 50%, but I think this guy I picked up, yeah, he's got 70 off the bat because he's got a perk here that gives him. So I'm going to go right here and cross my fingers. Yep, did it. Didn't spend any points. Got it.
Updated my
journal. This badge of office. All right, so now they got the badge of office. I'm going to save it again. Now I got to go talk to the clerk up here. And I have to get these papers, these forged papers, to release this. Now this one I found was kind of a pain. So you don't want to get into the conversation too deep, but start persuasion or intimidation or quick fingers. I think persuasion is the best one. 50, 60, yeah, so this guy has the best chance. So let's do 100%. Now, you say, I'd like to talk about paperwork. Now we do the persuasion again. And let's get another 100%. Okay, so what you'll get is this letter of pardon, and then you give it to Tiber. I call him a delightful maniac.
Making a note.
And then he creates a forged letter of pardon. All right, so now we've got a pardon letter. And we go back down. So you can see how many times we've seen quick fingers already.
Let's go.
Persuasion, quick fingers, deception. They're used so much in this game. And the outcomes are really favorable when you can actually use them. So I would suggest getting those skills. I'm going to go ahead and save it before I talk to this guy. And you want to talk to Yin, the Overseer. I'm going to show you exactly. Remember what I told you before? You needed to have that conversation. So the first thing I say is, this man has a full pardon. Release him. Well, then he says, you were here before and you didn't have the badge, right? If you didn't talk to this guy, this option wouldn't be available at all. So now you want to use deception here. 45, 70, and 45. Okay, so this guy has the best. So here's why I did this. Okay, so you let this guy go, or you free him. You free him either way, right? But because you used deception here and said you were undercover, look, you get this leather jerkin, which is actually better than what you started off with. And it's for your guy. And then this rapier, which is also really good. It's not as good as the, and you get 40 XP, right? It's not as good as the crystal shard that you have, but that's okay. Now, I read online that these two, you know, had a friendly conversation, but they don't. They split ways. And you run into this guy later. It doesn't really matter here. This really is just to kind of set the tides in whatever direction that you want to go, so you can select whatever options you want. All right, so now check this out, right? So I hold down shift, and I can see what I'm currently equipped is this wool woven garment. It's got 3 resistance. This new thing has 1 armor and 2 resistance. All right, so, and they're both light and they don't have any negative effects. So I'm going to equip this new armor. We also got this rapier, right? So this rapier, I think for this guy, yeah. So look at this. So what he's got equipped is a 3 physical damage and then +4 damage per effort, max 4. So this will do 7 max. Where this other one is 3 and it will do +3 per effort and it does a max of 9. So this one will do 12. So this one overall, I think, is better. I'll give him this knife or sword. Okay, so we just did our first series of quests, and now check this out, right? I just leveled up already, and we barely got into the game. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and level this guy up. This increased edge, I think, is a good one, right? So anything intellect-based is good. So we can try that, or I like these as well. Ability or skill, These are always helpful. I can undo my endurance here, which will put it just at neutral, and I'll get +5 at every level. But I think I'll do increased edge at this point. Once you've picked increased edge for this tier, like I'm tier 1, you can't pick it again. So you eventually get to pick, I think, all of those things. All right, so that was pretty good. Now, next thing you do, okay? This, to me, is one of the most crucial steps in the beginning of the game. All right, so money is an issue, always. And I have, where's my money? Why do I not see those? Oh, there it is, 166. Okay, so to replenish your pools, you need to sleep. And sleeping, the cheapest I've seen it is 20 per head. So if I want to, that's 80. That's half of the money that I've got just to get my pool back. There is an option here when you're talking to these guys to be able to sleep here for free, indefinitely, forever. And you can come back to them as often as you want, and it doesn't cost you anything. To me, at the beginning of the game, it's invaluable. It saves you so much money and effort. So we're going to go ahead and do that. So we're going to talk to these guys, and I'll tell you when it's important. There's one option that if you don't select, you're hosed the entire way. I would recommend saving. I'm actually going to... Oh, look at this. Here's the option. You have to do something. If you say, no, I'm not the changing god, you will not get this option. You have to say, I am the changing god. And then you have to then here say, I am, right?
I'll remember that.
And then say, I will fix the clock, because this clock side quest is really important too. It gives you a whole bunch of stuff. You'll see here in a second. Okay, so now check this out. So I'm not going to save it yet. I just want to validate because I've never done it this way. Oh, I have to do the
yes.
I have to do the clock. Examine the machine here. You have one of your flashbacks.
I remember that.
And it hits these three things, and you know you have to interact with them. So, I'm going to go ahead and click this one. And I have forgotten which ones these were, so let me tab out of here real quick. So, first of all, you got to look more closely and examine the images. All right, so this one. So this first one is look at the memory in the Lush Valley, and then you lock in the Lush Valley to this device, and then leave it. You can see the little ribbon there, the little power ribbon. That means it's locked in.
All right.
Underwater City, look at that, and then lock it in. And then this final one is look at the memory of the city under siege, and then lock in the besieged city.
Ready to learn something.
All right, so we got it. So the clock is now working again. Okay, so now we gotta go touch the clock again. And it's going to take you into your subconscious where you talk to these three jokers, and you come back out, get some goodies. The options in here only affect the tides, so there's nothing, I don't think there's anything else in here. I just make sure that I hit all the chat options. I don't see any way out, progresses it. Why can't you get a sound? Why did you change the clock? This right here, I choose an aspect of myself. That advances. I'm what they call a nano. I built a path. I don't have the ability that you're talking about. And then shut your eyes, search for memories of this ability that they speak of. So there, I just got 100 XP for that, which is great. So now you get one of these extra abilities. So Master Defense, this one's pretty good. But as a non-melee, I don't think it really does much for me. This one's actually pretty good, right? Plus 5 on quick fingers, plus 5 on deception and perception. The sneak attack I'll probably never use because I won't be hidden. Now, I don't know if that's gain. Let me see, gain 10% on attacks. I don't know if that's with esoteric attacks. That actually, I didn't think about that before. This actual natural charisma is pretty good too. Plus 1 on persuasion, deception, and intimidation tasks. Okay. That's pretty good too. So either of these are good. I think I'm going to do this one just for fun. So these skills you pick up kind of along the way. You don't always just pick things up when you level like a traditional RPG, a CRPG that you play. That's one of the things I think is really cool about this game is there's so many different ways to advance your character. And they're not traditional ways either. And for me, it's kind of like a an Easter egg hunt. I'm always looking for how to figure out that, how to get the best character that I can. So I love it. I still this is like my fifth time playing this beginning, and it's taken me a while to get all of these things down so that I don't screw it up, and I kind of maximize what I'm trying to do here. All right, so now you just have to leave. So run all the way down there. Now, once you complete this quest, you advanced another level, I believe, and you're gonna have a place where you can sleep for free, which is significant. So now we're going to talk to Casimene to complete it. Tell him I met these three.
I'll remember that.
And there, another 100 XP. So I leveled up again. Allegern leveled up again.
Here. Now.
So, extra effort, stat pool. We got the edge, so let's do skill or ability. Let's see what the ability is. Onslaught. So I can improve Onslaught. But you know, I so far haven't seen a ton of combat in the game. So I might go with the skill, because the skills are pretty important. I could do this one right here is pretty good because this is how you remember all of your memories, which is an important piece of the game. So I think I'm gonna select that.
I've learned something new.
Now let's go to Allegern, advance him. So he's got increased edge or improved skills. So we can improve his skills. Meh. I guess we could do smashing, but let's give him a might because he's more of a melee guy. Let's give him a might.
Ready to face the world.
Okay, so now let's talk to her again. She calls you Your Holiness. That's a good sign. I would like to sleep here. You may stay with us for as long as you like. Boom, free. So that's huge. So that series of quests and those selections, for me, is a huge difference in how you play this game in the beginning. And if you don't do it, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg. And it's really tough to make money in the beginning of the game. So I'm going to save it now. I've quick saved it. That was the first series of quests that are most important. Now,
all right.
I'm going to do one more before I call it a night. And this is a pretty easy one, but you get some cool gear and you'll level up again afterwards. It requires some running around. You want to talk to the sculptor guy. Okay, you want to use the anamnesis. See, now I have the edge. You see that here? So I have a 75% chance right off the bat. All right, I got it. Good. I probably should have quick saved before just to make certain. But that's okay. So I just try to hit all the conversation points.
Updated my journal.
Okay. So now we've talked to him. First place we need to go is the underbelly, which you can get to right here.
Let's go.
Skipping over all the other people and everything right now because I don't really care about it right yet because I want to get through this first series. So you want to enter here. This is the cult. What is this? The Dendra O'Hur. The cult of Dendra O'Hur. Okay. You want to run up here. You want to inspect this corpse. Lift the shroud, touch the tattoo, you get some XP, you take a hit point, and then you leave the corpse, and now you want to go talk to this guy. Let him touch your forehead, that's fine. I'm not the man you think I am. Now, a sculptor told me you may find a man killed by a strange thing, okay? That's what advances it, okay? Now we can leave.
Fine.
Now we gotta go find these, gotta go kind of look through these ruins. And that's over here.
Find them.
I haven't discovered
something
it yet. This is City's Edge. Yeah, this is where I want to be. So I want to run up here, and I want to talk to one of these three ladies. These are the cult of the Changing God, I think, ladies. I'm skipping over everyone else, because there are other quests along the way, but I'm going to ignore it for now. I'm going to talk to her. My bad. You gotta do this first. You gotta search the rubble.
I'll remember that.
Let's study the horizon here. I always select that option.
I'll remember that.
And now let's dig through. I think Allegern's probably got the best. 50% off the bat. No, he does too. He doesn't use might quite as much, so. Let's try this. Actually, let's just, yeah. Now let's slam dunk it. Cause I don't think I quick saved it.
I'll remember that.
A new reflection is forming in the labyrinth. That's green. So search for anything else. Search for anything else. Oh, looky there. Found a little tchotchke. Okay, some money. So now I'm going to save. And now I want to talk to this lady. Now you have all these extra options here. There, the Sorrow's Prey just advanced. Good day. All right, so now what we want to do is we want to go this way. And you know what? I'm going to stop here at this merchant, and I'm going to sell off a bunch of this stuff just so I have some money. That. I can sell that. I can sell this. Anything that says oddity, you're pretty safe to sell. Okay. You know, I might hang on to this armor for now. And some of these weapons. But now I have 377 shins, which is pretty good. And what's this here? This is an artifact. Oh yeah, negative one level in persuasion skill, minus three initiative. Ugh. I don't want that. So, you know, at this point, I really don't buy anything.
Go.
All right, so over here, you want to talk to the Zeb kid. Give him five shins.
I'll remember that.
And you just want to advance the story here a little bit. You can talk to him, tell me about your family. But you want to hear, tell me about Avena. And then farewell. Now you want to talk to her. She wants you to give her money, but you don't need to. Can I ask you some questions? Someone sell children here. That advances it. Show me what you found. I'm curious. Say it's not yours. I have to return it to its rightful owner. And then you could do either one of these. It just affects your tie, but I do. It's for a good cause, I promise.
Making a note.
And then you get this interdimensional puzzle box. You can go in your inventory and use the item. You can examine it, smell it, squeeze it, and you can't really do anything with it. Okay? Okay, so now this next part is kind of a pain. It took me a while, but you have to die. And to die, you want to go into this fifth eye tower. You want to die because you go back into the labyrinth when that happens. To die, you want to come on over here and you want to talk to this ghostly woman. She will also set you on another quest as well. So study your face, listen to the whispers, listen to the whispers again. Who are you? Do not try to escape. Let the ghost strangle you. This, you'll die and you'll go back into the labyrinth, which is exactly what you want to do. You actually gain some XP from it.
I'm hurt.
All right, chat her up real quick and she'll actually start. I think we're in the labyrinth, a construct of your mind. And she'll actually, this starts the Ashen Imitation. How do I find these women? There's three of them. Okay, so that's it.
Of course.
Go down here to get out. Talk to the specter here again. Ask him about these fathoms. What should I do now? How do other can other fathoms open again? Yes. How do I get back this time? Anything changed? Are you always here? What should I do now? Okay. So I've asked him everything. Alright, so now we got this little empty reflection down here. We want to go talk to this dude. Or her, I should say. Dudette.
I'll remember that.
You can talk to it a little bit. And then place the puzzle box. That. Who are you? Oops. Who is your adopted father? I'm sorry this happened to you. No, it wasn't wrong, but you're here now. Okay, a creature named the Sorrow, Carcello. Do you know anything else about him? What does this puzzle box mean to you? So, look at this. This is what I was telling you about. There are so many other ways that you advance without actually advancing. You just got this thing called Saria's Peace, which gives you a +1 might, speed, and intellect pool. So all your pool is just raised by 1 point, which is pretty darn good, especially for the very beginning of the game.
All right.
All right, so now we're going to go ahead and leave. Back.
You're back. Adventure awaits. Somewhere.
Eritus is pretty funny. He's kind of cuckoo, so he says all kinds of crazy things. All right, now we want to go back to what is it, Circus Minor? I think that's what we call it. Circus Minor. Yep. And we'll turn in the quest here. All right, we want to go down here. So we'll do this. You get this really cool, like, wispy, invisible cloak thing here that protects you from melee attacks. And I think everyone levels up. I think you get 100 XP or something here. So I'm going to go ahead and F5 and save it. Quick save and talk to the sculptor. His daughter was killed. Now, I've never tried these lies. You could try these and maybe you get something different.
I'll remember that.
Oh, so we got 40 XP. Yeah. So you get the Spirit Shroud. Look at this, pretty cool. When damaged by any of the damage types, it converts Spiritual Shroud, which is 15% evasion for one round. So that's pretty cool. So he's also working on something with a sculpture. So at some point, maybe you come back and you talk to him again. So here, I'll put the Shroud on as a cloak. You can see, zoom in, it's like a little wispy invisible cloak. It's pretty cool.
Why, of course.
All right, so these two guys just leveled up, right? So that's good. This guy actually, I think, is tier 2 after this. Increased stat pool. Which guy is this again? This is, oh yeah, this is my speed guy, so I'm going to want to put 2 points here in speed.
I've learned a thing or two.
So he gets, yep, you've reached tier 2, issue challenge, and then I get to choose one of these. I'm going to go ahead and do skill, because he's kind of a melee guy, skill with defenses. And let's go to Eritus. Let's level him up, and he's tier 2 as well. Let's make him my smashing guy, so I'll give him that. He gets 2 new tier 2 abilities because he's a glaive, I think. Yeah, he's a glaive. Oh, look at that. Kinetic overdrive. +3 might, +3 speed. That's pretty cool. 5% gain from each level of effort spent on smashing or quick figure. So good. So we selected smashing, and so he's going to benefit greatly from that. This fell swoop is kind of an AoE attack. I think that's pretty good, so I'm going to go ahead and select that. And I'm also, he is my heavy weapons guy, so I'm gonna give him a heavy weapon. He's already got melee, and then I'm gonna give him a heavy weapon. All right. Now I'm gonna go ahead and save it again, just to be safe. And there you go. That right there is, you're gonna be set up really well to play this game at this point. You've got a couple levels under your belt, you got some money, you got some items, you got some gear. You've got free sleeping, which is, to me, the biggest thing you can do in the beginning of the game. And now I would just kind of move on and do anything however you want. The rest of the game, I mean, there's so much other stuff to this, but whatever you do, this is a really good setup for the rest of the game. And with that, I'm going to call it a night. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys soon.